Hi, everyone. I'm Ira Wagman at Carleton University. Great to be with you today for this panel, which is entitled Broadcast and Digital Media. Thank you to everybody who is organizing the panel. Thank you, David, for your technical support for this session. In just a minute, I'll start introducing the panelists for this session. In addition, what I'll be doing is I'll be acting as the moderator for the question and answer period. So any of you who have questions for any of the speakers, feel free to enter them into the chat box, and then I will kind of collate them and organize them and then relay them back to the speakers. And of course, if I do a really poor job of relaying that, you're welcome to jump in and correct me.
So Lowell Gasoi is next, and the paper is entitled Open Media, Vernacular Advocacy in Canadian Media Policy.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much to Sarah and her whole team for putting this event together and for giving me a chance to speak to you for a little bit today. In one of my very favorite television portrayals of idealized liberal politics, the West Wing, in the episode Talking Points, our press secretary, Allison Janney's C.J. Craig here, plays the role of our friend Dwayne Wincek and attempts to lead reporters to a story on rapidly concentrated media ownership amidst government inaction. When she fails to get reporters to criticize, as she puts it, their media mogul robber baron bosses, Craig has maintenance staff physically remove a percentage of seats in the White House press briefing room. To decry this paucity of voices in the news media, that the West Wing writers foresaw dangerous levels of media amalgamation is certainly interesting, but what always thrilled me about this storyline is not the relatively obvious policy critique, but rather the physicality, the immediacy of Craig's intervention. What makes Craig's example pertinent to us today is that she is attacking the very media machine that she's meant to serve, a stance not unheard of in recent press secretaries. I want to suggest that Craig's joiners and carpenters physically altering the press room seating is an example of vernacular advocacy. And for the next few minutes, I'd like to share with you how I understand this concept and then deploy it to talk about the work of two real-life advocacy organizations with just as much vigor and valor as the fictional Miss Craig, and that being our friends at Open Media and the Quebec Arts Advocacy Organization, the English Language Arts Network, or ELAN. Well, Canadian cultural policy has always been informed by two fairly major issues. A landmass, huge landmass with a small population, and of course our proximity to the cultural superpower that is the US of A. We often turn to our own Harold Innes to explain the importance of infrastructure and channels of distribution and such, but also for the importance of hearing our own voices amidst the thunder from down south. Nationalistic and technological questions are vital, but they can often crowd out meaningful questions that are closer to the lived experiences of media makers and policymakers on the more local level. They also don't really address the important questions around cultural policy and those lived experiences, particularly as they relate to questions of advocacy. So, what is a vernacular advocacy then? I see it as an extension of Bill Kirkpatrick's concept of vernacular media policy. In his 2013 article, Kirkpatrick makes a convincing argument about the locality and directionality of certain media policies. He's concerned that relegating media policy to the rarefied air of multinational corporations and state-level actors will cause us to miss the study of ground-level policy and the impact on our daily practices. No TV before your homework is done, he reminds us, is just as much a media policy as any CRTC ruling or CanCon regulation or Netflix tax. Citing John Fiske and Michel Foucault, Kirkpatrick gives us a policy power that moves, that circulates and points, rather than simply boosting or suppressing certain political economic potentials. C.J. Craig removes the chairs, mom and dad hide the remote. Both are bottom-up policy actions that directly implicate the actors and their space and access to the process. Des Friedman builds on this embodied sense of policy that Kirkpatrick suggests, shifting from Foucault to Marx, and warning of the dangers of a policy fetishism. Reifying the policy text abstracts it from the individual, mystifying the process and leaving us with, as he states, very little connection to or involvement in the policy debates that structure our communicative environment. If, as Friedman argues, policy is always trying to erase itself, policy texts are trying to erase itself, making those texts inaccessible through specialized language and closed spaces, perhaps an answer is to extend our understanding of those texts to include their embodiment and their presence. Vernacular advocacy pays attention to this wider discursive notion of texts, making the process visible and perhaps even heard. As Justin Eckstein argues, sound as argumentation and advocacy, such as the roar of student protesters drowning out a speech by James Comey, challenges the primacy of textual mediation. Judith Butler, in writing about assembly, points to the power of the silent vigil of still bodies as a means to speak back to power. More often than not, the concerns of scholars like Kirkpatrick and Friedman are sidelined in our push to align our language and our theorizations with that of the prominent or dominant policy discourse, the written word, the prepared speech, the regulation, the legalese, and very often a mostly deterministic view of technology. So we come to the question asked so succinctly by Audre Lorde, can the master's tools dismantle the master's house? And former Open Media Managing Director Riley Yao suggests that we need the internet to save the internet. And can we provide some insight into that process as a vernacular advocacy? In a 2012 editorial for Media Development, Yao writes, "The more sites where democracy doesn't happen, the more undemocratic our society is." Like Friedman, Yao offers a vision of a closed-door policy process that is impenetrable to the uninitiated. Open Media's response has been to engage their supporters through online petitions, campaigns, a practice often derided as clicktivism. Yao counters by insisting that their online actions have resulted in significant policy change and are a key component to other actions, like the presence of Open Media's former CEO, Steve Anderson, at CRTC hearings, and his sharing of intimate personal experiences drawn through consultations that they performed. Now, we know that there are multiple sites, then, where policy is being developed, challenged, implemented. It's not only specialized language that is effective, but representations of the lived experiences of individuals. Testimonials are one way to challenge the language gap between everyday media consumers, advocates, and policymakers. Now, Open Media provides an ideal example of this complex process, not only through their strategic deployment of hashtags and online campaigns and physical presence at hearings, but also through their corporate culture. In a 2016 blog post explaining what open media is, Anderson and his colleague Alexa Patoulis eschew the traditional roles of think tank or consumer group or watchdog, seeking a new language, something like a civic engagement platform. As Riyanka Singh has suggested, this idea of the platform in our digitalized world can be reclaimed in its more theatrical sense as a space for visibility and demonstration. In other words, we might seek to reinvest the idea of the platform with its human presence. Even the organizational structure of open media shifts toward the living and organic human. Anderson has expressed the organization's commitment to some of the tenets of what organizational scholar Frederick Laloux calls a teal organization. Teal structures are on the opposite end of a continuum with reactive and power-centered red organizations, traditional hierarchical power structures of ambers like the army or the government, orange multinationals that are hyper-focused on competition, beating the other guy, and even greens that push a kind of a family-like culture. The teals highlight a distributed, self-managed style that Laloux likens to a living and evolving organism. This kind of organic metaphor is an interesting one considering open media's success, and perhaps it's a seemingly productive way to insert the human presence back into the advocacy process. With limited time left, I want to touch on briefly another example, the Quebec English Language Arts Network, which is an advocacy coalition of artists and cultural workers that seek to advance the interests of minority Anglophone cultural creators in Quebec. For Elan, advocacy is central to what they do, and yet their former executive director, Guy Rogers, has shared with me that in some interviews we did together that explaining this importance to their members can be daunting because the process is often invisible. Guy tells me that advocacy is a form of mediation, suggesting that there are codes present in the language of advocacy, the long of advocacy. His challenge, relating these codes as activated, as parole, in the practices of artists demonstrating their legitimacy, for instance, shared among networks of advocates and crystallized into specific forms and texts, including cultural policies. Being in the room with the culturecrats that develop and implement policies that directly affect a land's members is vital to translating those members' needs and experiences into policy realities. So Guy will often make specific trips to Ottawa to sign off on agreements and funding with Heritage or the Canada Council. Like Anderson's presence at hearings with Open Media, Guy's presence is a human link between the texts and online consultations and the living, breathing artists that depend on these policy outcomes to create the environment for stable and sustainable artistic careers. Ilan has even suggested that the creation of a cultural center of excellence where artists and intermediaries might come together in one space to share capacities and languages to better their advocacy. In the paroxysm of policy response to the pandemic, I'm convinced that we must attend not only to describing the actions, texts, and procedures of policymakers, but, as Friedman argues, in considering the questions policy is asking itself. When Open Media asks us whether it is right that we pay higher internet fees, that's a worthy question, but just as important is how we will pursue that policy change, using the master's tools to bring down the master's house, or through means more immediate and present. In seeking to highlight the contributions of Quebec's English language artists to the cultural fabric of the province, we must also ask how and with whom policy can enhance those connections, if that is in fact a part of its function. In terms of advocacy in the policy process, we need to look more closely at these immediate relationships that bring the process closer to our lives, fostering wider and more robust engagement with citizens, and particularly the artists and producers who make the media being regulated. C.J. Craig reminds us that while symbols matter in cultural policy, embodiment and presence of policy on the ground is also vital. Sometimes you just might need to work in the vernacular, rearrange the chairs to realign our policy ideals. Thanks very much for your time. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Lowell. That was great. So next up will be Daniel Keyes, and the paper is entitled The Canadian Media Fund and Google YouTube's channel Encore Plus, CanCon's Archival Salvation or Digital Waste Bin.
Hello, my name is Daniel Keyes. I'd like to preface this talk by acknowledging I'm speaking in the Okanagan, the unceded territories of the Silk people. More work needs to be done than that. The focus of the talk is on Encore Plus, asking whether it is a form of archival salvation for Canadian content or a digital waste bin. Amid Canada's 150 celebrations on November 7th, 2017, the Canadian Media Fund, hereafter referred to as the CMF, launched Encore Plus, a YouTube channel. Encore Plus hosts lost Canadian television programs and film the CMF and Telefilm originally funded. This talk evaluates Encore Plus. I will briefly discuss Canadian audiovisual archival history and shifts into audiovisual media delivery in Canada as a way of situating Encore Plus. The 1995 report by Libraries and Archives Canada titled Fading Away, strategic plan options to ensure the protection of and access to audiovisual memory led to the creation of the AV Trust as a consortium of stakeholders and nonprofits or corporations to allow the protection and compatible access to Canadian audiovisual heritage via, quote, a decentralized approach to preservation of these cultural resources. Unfortunately, the AV Trust's federal funding was denied in 2008 by the Harper government, ending one archival dream for Canadian audiovisual material. In 2017, Keeley Wilkinson of the Canadian Broadcast Foundation pitch the use of the decommissioned ORAD bunker as a repository for masters that appeared his peers in 2021 who have not gained any traction. For archivists in the 2010s with cloud computing reality, the idea of archives as carceral repositories preserving original content with limited access to fragile documents is giving way to the idea of digital post-custodial open archives. Archivist Laura Miller announces in 2011 that Libraries and Archives Canada's, quote, monopoly as stewards of the national documentary heritage is over. She proposes that archivists would no longer wait to acquire archives physically in order to ensure that they were protected and available. Instead, archivists could maintain records control by providing advice and support to records creators and by overseeing the management of agency records and archives. This strategy to move away from the preservation of unique objects to record keeping seems to sidestep the issue that digitalization brings up with it of accelerated ephemerality. Digital platforms that today offer instant access to texts can vanish for a variety of reasons. Copyright law that restricts access behind paywalls, software under hardware failure under obsolescence, and copyright holders who lose track of digital or analog texts as one media company swallows another media company unaware of the inventory of the old media, as is the case with many of Encore Plus's rescue missions. Canadian media in 2021 reflects a changing landscape that has seen over the last decade a shift as viewers continue to cut cords with cable subscribers. The Canadian mediascape favors the move to subscription video on demand. Google and YouTube ad revenue model introduces the notion that non-subscription or free video can harness a revenue model, not unlike commercial broadcast television with pop-up ads while gathering data on users. So what is Encore Plus? Encore Plus is a YouTube channel funded by CMF and partners like Telefilm that showcases Canadian taxpayer-funded audiovisual content. Due to copyright law and a tendency of broadcasters and film studios to lock and forget media content vaults after its initial commercial broadcast or release, much of Canadian commercial audiovisual heritage remains hidden. After elaborate legal work on copyright agreements for rights holders, Encore Plus digitizes analog media content and uploads it to YouTube. The digital transfer firm Deluxe, based in Toronto, handles the transfer from analog to digital, with the analog master tapes or reels and master and a digital copy returned to the rights holder, who are free to remove their content from Encore Plus services or earn revenue from ads that run with the content on Encore Plus. The preservation of the masters is beyond the remit of Encore Plus. For archival purists concerned with maintaining the original in perpetuity, this approach is dangerous. When the rights to audiovisual content revert to the initial creator after 20 to 30 years, Encore Plus staff locates the analog content and clears copyright permissions with the directors, the actors, the writers, and musician guilds. To avoid directly competing with new television and films, Encore Plus tends to avoid material produced after 2013. Consequently, Encore Plus viewers may find a sense of Canadian audiovisual heritage as belonging to the late 1980s and early 1990s, reflecting a very white complexion with shows like Do Sell featured. So what is the right holder's experience like? Encore does not pay royalties, but pays right holders based on a percentage of the ad revenue collected by YouTube. Right holders earn the majority of the ad revenue, with Encore Plus and YouTube taking tiny percentages. With some uploaded content, the ad revenue may be slight, but in other cases, it can be substantial. It may even spark interest in rebooting an old property or seeing the digital copy removed from Encore Plus and relicensed. Some producers of old content chide at Encore Plus's model, preferring the guaranteed upfront royalty model of regular broadcast. Abraka Kantam, a director of Encore Plus, with whom I interviewed for this article, asserts that Encore Plus returns, quote, content that Canadians have already paid for. Working with YouTube, the revenue that would normally flow to pirates on YouTube is diverted via Encore to the legal rights holders. The question of authenticity and provenance is one balanced against that of access. For Encore Plus, rights management is complex. For example, the feature film Lotus Eaters, from 1993 was very expensive to use because of one song in one scene. So that song was removed from the version posted on Encore Plus. Encore Plus does not note this change in its gloss of the film. I suspect this sort of sonic reduction is exactly what would concern preservationists who fear the mass destruction of the original master magnetic tapes of films in the rush to digitize content will inevitably generate irretrievable losses. Kanten Abraka's view is that audiences are still able to engage with the lost film with a slight modification that in no way ruins the experience of the film. So what is the user's experience like? The average viewing time on YouTube hovers around 2 to 3 minutes. Encore Plus, with its long-form content, has an average viewing time of 16 minutes. Encore Plus's content promotes stickiness. YouTube social media affordances offer a different type of engagement than offered by linear TV, as users are able to comment on programs. Encore Plus thrives not just as a place to watch old Canadian content, but also as a place for viewers to engage with the content between themselves. For example, the TV movie Deadly Friends, The Life and Death of Aunt Nancy Eaton, has over 700 comments from users discussing mental health, violence, and criminal system. Another example is the May 2023 watch party Encore Plus offered with the actor Martha Henry revisiting her performance in the 1986 film Dancing in the Dark. Other achievements include Encore Plus's relaunch of the first Canadian film directed by a woman, Sally Springs' Madeline Is, from 1969, or its playlist of the Imaginative Film and Media Arts Festival that offers brilliant contemporary Indigenous films. 60% of Encore Plus's users are from outside of Canada, demonstrating that hidden Canadian content can gain a new audience. However, Encore Plus is prone to quirky loss due to its archive as commodity structure. For example, a student in my Canadian Screens course was studying Deepa Mehta's Sam and Me, a 1991 film, and saw it disappear from Encore Plus on April Fool's Day when the contract between Encore Plus and the Directors Guild of Canada lapsed. A few weeks later, when the contract was signed, this film and all other films in English governed by that agreement returned to Encore Plus. So now it's time for my conclusions. Encore was 5 years in the making before its launch in 2017. I've been wondering why the CMF in 2017 did not use the National Film Board's video streaming platform, but ended up with Google. In hindsight, with concerns about Google YouTube's data mining, lack of user privacy, third-party ads being used to influence voters, partnering with an American company that does not pay taxes in Canada and whose ad revenue model has contributed to gutting journalism in Canada, may appear as a marriage of unequal partners. Still, I do not know if Encore Plus with the NFB would have had the global success that Encore Plus has generated. So, well, one might cynically see Encore Plus as a bargain bin of cast-off CanCon, where its 144,000 subscribers are easily dwarfed by YouTube video game blogger and alt-right star PewDiePie's 110 million users. I sense there's a value in having this admittedly lumpy archives providing this content. Encore Plus justifies the CMF and Telefilm's mandate by demonstrating that CanCon can find an appreciative global audience. Encore Plus presents a living archives in terms of meaning, making, and engagement. So while I chide against Encore Plus's achievement in regards to archival priorities like authenticity, preservation, and provenance, it provides living archives for lost CanCon. Encore Plus provides an alternative to the walled garden of streaming video on demand that I hope will prove a stable place for CanCon audiovisual heritage to reside and grow.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Daniel. Okay. So next up, we have Taeyoung Kim, and the paper is entitled Cultural Politics of CanCon in SVOD Markets, a Case Study of Netflix Canada.
Good afternoon from Vancouver. My name is Taeyoung Kim. I'm a session instructor at Simon Fraser University. When I first submitted my profile to the conference organizers, I introduced myself as PhD candidate, but I defended my doctoral thesis 2 weeks ago. So this is kind of my first time to introduce myself as PhD graduate. I really appreciate the conference organizers, Professor Sarah Bannerman, Professor David Auburn, and Professor Tamara Shefford, and members of the organizing team of this wonderful conference to let me introduce my work about cultural politics of Canadian content in the Canadian SVOD market. My research is based on, aims at understanding the presence of Netflix Canada in the Canadian policy context in relation to Canadian content. I use two research methods. One is document research on policy documents published by CBC, CRTC, and the Department of Canadian Heritage, which cover about issues over Netflix. Then I also conducted catalog analysis on Netflix Canada, as well as Crave, the largest domestic SVOD service platform across the nation. When it comes to understanding SVOD platforms, subscription video on demand, much of my analysis assume that understand SVOD as platform, which refers to building block, which can be a product, a technology, or a service that acts as the foundation upon which other firms can develop complementary products, technologies, and services. Along with over-the-tops, SVODs can be considered as platforms because they allow content developers to systematically track and profile the activities and preferences of billions of users. They not only represent the digitalization of the media industries, the rise of SVOD imply and accompany with the fundamental shifts in production, distribution, and consumption of media content. In regard to understand SVOD as platforms, one thing that I wanted to mention is that SVOD, as well as SVOD market, are subject to pre-existing power dynamics as platforms, which are outcomes of pre-existing technological development inherited by structural asymmetries. In other words, the current situation, the current infrastructure of SVOD market and the players in the market, the entire structure is overall benefited by pre-existing dynamics of the media industries in general, which means that several US-based media conglomerates and technological capital are still enjoying their advantages in the SVOD market. When it comes to streaming wars between companies in the Canadian market, SVOD companies in the Canadian market, we can easily observe that there's a strong presence of US-based SVOD platforms in the Canadian market. So, according to a recent statistics as of 2019, Netflix has more than 16.5 million subscribers across the nation, followed by Amazon Prime Video, which has 6.5 million subscribers, followed by Disney Plus and Apple TV Plus and others. So they garnered more than $1.57 billion in revenue in 2019. In contrast, the largest domestic SVOD provider, Crave, which is owned by Bell Media, only has 2.8 million subscribers across the nation and made $292.5 million in the same period, followed by Sportsnet Now, owned by Rogers, with 0.5 million subscribers, with the revenue of $172.7 million. So in total, all the domestic players earned just barely more than $5 million for their revenue in 2019. So pretty much one third of the revenue compared to their American competitors. So we can simply figure out that there is a structural asymmetry exists in the SVOD market, Canadian SVOD market, between US-based SVOD platforms and Canadian counterparts. Based on analysis on policy document relevant to issues of Netflix, we can say that there is a tendency that the Canadian authority want to or are willing to interpret Netflix and SVOD platforms as a means of promoting Canadian content. In addition to that, there are the rise of SVOD and SVOD players are generally considered as general goods in a number of trade agreements and legal issues, rather than media or culture products. This means that they are exempted from some protectionist measure that the Canadian federal government has imposed to media industries. They're also exempted from regulations of CRTC and other regulatory bodies, in contrast to Canadian broadcasters, such as the quota of Canadian content, antitrust regulation on bundles, and etc. And as we all know from the controversies over imposing Netflix tax in 2018 to 2020, they're not paying taxes to Canadian government, in contrast to Canadian broadcasters and film distributors. But still, there is a tendency that the Canadian government is expecting that SVOD platforms are means of promoting Canadian content worldwide. However, based on my analysis on catalogs of Netflix Canada, as well as Craig, we can see that there's like Canadian content is still highly marginalized when it comes to being distributed by those SVOD platforms. Among more than 5,700 films and television series that are distributed by Netflix, only 29 television series and 73 films are labeled as Canadians. Such a situation is not much different from Crave, even if it's a domestic company, because they're only like serving 26 television series and films that are labeled as Canadians. So the vast majority of content that both SVOD platforms are serving the population across the nation, there is not much presence for Canadian content. Meanwhile, CBC Gem, which is mandate to promote and protect Canadian content, the platform itself is highly marginalized position in the market. So their presence and their strength to protect and promote Canadian content in the SVOD market is not much strong. So what we can find is that not only US-based SVODs, but also Canadian SVODs favor US products. Definitely, this also imply that such a distribution and such an asymmetry existing in the distribution of Canadian content and foreign content, including, of course, most of them are American, that means to audiences as well. So among the top 20 most in-demand streaming content, including Disney Plus's Mandalorian, Netflix's The Witcher, and Apple TV Plus's The Morning Show, all of them are US media products. That's kind of the top, one of the top rankings that Canadian audiences want. Meanwhile, the highest ranked Canadian content that SVOD subscribers desired or expected was N with an E, a CBC series. So while many of them, including Stranger Things, The Handmaid's Tale, or The Umbrella Academy, were partially filmed in Canada, especially in Toronto and Vancouver. And of course, we can assume that they got some kind of a benefit from the provincial government or for the federal government by following the rule of like Canadian content or like promoting some kind of Canadian media industries. But we do not expect them, or we do not generally consider them as Canadians. That's kind of the thing that we heard from presentations from Monday, right? So distributors are important. Here's the thing. This we often studied that distributors are important because they have the right to choose which content to be delivered to their audiences. I believe that such an old theory that used to be like explained to television or like newspapers, the news cable channels, that applies to SVOD services as well. Their choices of distributing US content and not choosing Canadian content worsen the marginalized situation of the Canadian content in the market. Unlike television, which has some kind of minimum quota to promote Canadian content, pretty much the same as Canadian radios, there is not enough regulatory protectionist measure to promote and protect the Canadian content. So, unlike the expectation of policy authorities or promotion of several governmental bodies that expecting Netflix and SVOD platforms to be some kind of future distribution, like mean of promoting Canadian content, they do not function as distributor to serve the interest of Canadian media. Lack of protectionist measures on SVOD platforms, unlike television film, that often give US-based SVOD platforms some kind of free pass, just penetrating into the Canadian audiences. This worsened the marginalized position of Canadian films and television because more users and more population is trying to use SVOD rather than traditional television or like going to films, going to theaters. They're watching Netflix, they're subscribing Crave, they're subscribing Amazon Prime, but those kind of, based on my findings from catalog analysis, it doesn't seem that Canadian content is well promoted and preserved in those SVOD platforms. Yeah, so if you have any questions, of course, Q&A session is available, but if you have further questions, please do not hesitate to send me an email to my email. All right. Thanks for watching and listening my presentation. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a great presentation. And also thank you. Congratulations on defending your PhD. So two great presentation and great news. Congratulations on both. Okay, we'll keep the good times going here. Next up, we have Geneva Nam. And the paper is entitled Digital Streaming and New Media, the Future of Canadian Broadcast.
Hello, and thank you for inviting me to speak at the ComCult Policy Conference at McMaster University. My name is Geneva, and I was a student at Simon Fraser University, but due to the pandemic, the conference was postponed and I have since completed my studies. My research analyzes the shift in Canadian viewership from traditional cable systems to digital streaming services. I analyzed data provided by the CRTC's study, Harnessing Change, the Future of Programming Distribution. In their analysis, the CRTC identified key data that marked a stiff decline in cable package purchases. Draining this viewership are the new media platforms and private digital streaming sites that are available over the internet, the vast majority of which are not domestic Canadian companies. Now, with the context of digital streaming trends in mind, can Canada navigate a neutral streaming environment while still upholding its Canadian content goals? Canadian broadcasting policy has maintained its support in favor of Canadian content and are able to control viewership through licensing, renewals, and evaluations. Part one of the study analyzes internet use trends. There is no digital streaming without infrastructural networks in place to facilitate the downloads. And so for this section, there was a definite emphasis on those who have and have not, and the differences between the French and English. So firstly, for French and English groups, there are distinct differences between rural or remote communities, which may or may not have access to broadband speeds available to those in urban markets. This is emphasized in Market Insight 1. According to the research by the CRTC, the true driving force behind this rise of broadband internet in this country is demand for real-time entertainment, and particularly video, which accounts for 2/3 of the capacity of fixed networks and 1/3 of the capacity of mobile networks. So without access to higher speeds in rural areas, there is a clear digital divide for those outside medium to large city centers. This is important for reference to third language communities, as well as those referenced during our first panel on day one, where it was emphasized that even regions just outside of Ottawa were suffering from poor quality digital connections to internet systems. Part two of the study notes the difference between audience viewership and emphasizes the added benefit of personalization. Claims that technology has changed the nature of viewership are accurate in this sense. In particular, there is a large shift from scheduled to an on-demand viewership. Moreover, this is coupled with increased diversity in programs available. The inconclusive evidence, as shown in the study, argue that whether online viewing represents a shift or is part of an overall increase in viewing across all platforms, it is clear that traditional TV viewing is in decline. As noted by the increasingly large portion of online TV as marked in blue. Part three assesses the importance of public funding. Government funding acts as a promoter of programming diversity, where other institutions and foreign broadcasters may not have similar interests. CanCon requirements have always been a strong component of Canadian broadcasting, and the study indicates public funding makes possible the production of content that wouldn't be made otherwise, and helps stabilize production levels relative to fluctuations in the market. It has become a less prominent component over time as industry revenues have grown, but this is still significant, as indicated in Figure 22, Market Insight 11. Programming in this landscape is ripe in competition, and this diagram introduces the idea of programming available by a single company, but for an entire world market. This poses a problem for Canadian broadcasters, both private and public, that they have been shielded from the past competition. Canadian best practices follow CRTC mandates for Canadian content programming, and this has shaped consumer expectations. However, digital platforms such as Netflix have challenged domestic broadcasting companies, as this company has shown by its world access that it has made strides in investing in diversity and using data to keep users interested in content on the platform. The global reach of Netflix has led to licensing deals that access the depth and breadth of the world's creators. The CRTC argues that it may be difficult for domestic services to replicate the content, budgets, and global reach of pure play digital services. So this would also reference Netflix, Hulu, and Disney Plus as examples of online streaming services. These online services have taught domestic players important lessons about the need for more effective approaches to user interface, discoverability, algorithms, and data collection. The arguments by Dwayne Winsek in challenging the existing netscapes of power, in this case, the power in the Canadian content context, has been propped up by the media conglomerate's single enclosed CanCon system. And moving into the next part, part five of the insights, discuss content on its own. Accessing content via platforms like YouTube allows users to be both the creator and the consumer. However, the study notes that long-form video production still favors large markets, such as the U.S. Since successful content comes from the U.S., markets can be sold in Canada at a fraction of what it actually costs to make a television program. It incents Canadian media companies to inquire and acquire foreign content and discourages the risk associated with creating original content that would cost multiple times more to finance and produce. In this section, the most staggering insight is the public policy is sustaining domestic production in virtually all genres. So as indicated below in figure 44, the current levels of Canadian content would not be sustainable without public support. And though the diagram is only screenshotted for the English language, you can see that the majority of genres are non-profitable. In response to these points offered by the CRTC study is the question, what has been done to address these issues? The common theme throughout these market insights is choice. From establishing personable schedules, personable pricing, and content, online there are options, curated and non-curated. The CRTC has failed to create the media environment that supports an effective mode of content as consumption. Specifically, it does not address over-the-top and other internet-based platforms where viewership is rapidly increasing. The results indicate that while the CRTC navigates the shifting new media landscape, the lagging initiative to regulate streaming platforms is only one step of the issue. Solutions need to meet a three-point dynamic system of coverage before it can effectively provide any form of equity through the act. So number one would be to establish network infrastructure. Number two, establish business controls that effectively manage foreign and domestic streaming sites, and would establish a set of business best practices or content oversight to ensure it meets Canadian broadcasting standards, as well as incentives for digital streaming site investment in Canadian media industry careers. So this comes at a whole different level of investing in the actual production side of the content. And third, channel financial profits back into Canadian content creators on these new platforms, and a very large portion has already been discussed through the example of Netflix for $500 million as an investment to the Canadian Media Fund. Of course, the big debate surrounding Bill C-10 is how these three points can be identified, realized, and most importantly, funded. As the figure 44 identified, there are no genres in the Canadian market that are self-sustainable without the aid of public funding. Commitments made by Netflix to invest, as mentioned previously, in Canadian content and the industry have set the stage for future platforms to shape the relationship between digital streaming services and Canadian broadcasting policymakers. The implications of this research extend beyond the exhibited applications. Promised investment in the Canadian Media Fund and other supporting bodies are a start, but the CRTC offers conclusions that promote equity in an existing unregulated system that is, in essence, unequal. Concerns regarding freedom of speech and the lack of public consultation and implemented changes echo the dissatisfaction, not only with the lack of initiative to accurately depict the shifting media environment, but also the lack of protections in place to guard the Canadian voice. This does not begin to cover the voices of the First Nations, Indigenous, Métis, as well as the ethnic media bodies. So the future of Canadian broadcast. This title is strong, but it's purposeful. The future of Canadian broadcast is wide open. The data indicates consultation is necessary in order to have revisions reflect Canadian interests on screen, off screen, and behind the scenes. Without parameters enforcing equity in digital streaming, enforcing equity in digital streaming platforms is unattainable. But without parameters enforcing equity in digital streaming platforms, this is unattainable. Canadian innovation can be inspired and fueled, and the last policy recommendation by the study seeks to develop new and adaptable innovative approaches to engage new players. In doing so, the CRTC recommends a focus on the production and promotion of reflective information and or entertaining high quality content by Canadians that is discoverable by Canadians and the rest of the world. So the challenge here is not simply just to create a media scape that allows Canadians to have access to choice and equitable voice, but also to establish one that is self-sustaining profitably and not simply just a copycat reiteration of what Netflix has been able to produce on the world stage. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Geneva. We have by my clock about 10 minutes for questions or comments from you, the audience. I guess this is one. This is just something that I noticed, maybe across all of the papers. So I'll kind of leave it to the panelists to jump in. But in some ways, one of the things that really stood out to me in each of these talks was the presence of, I guess, what I'm calling very loosely a kind of minor gestures, series of minor gestures, the placement of the transmitter, tweaks to the definition of what is multicultural, showing up in Lowell's presentation to hand off to sign documents, appearing in catalogs. For example, best practices is a theme that came up in Geneva's talk. So, across all of these different talks, what we have are a series of we tend to talk about policy making in the kind of grand scale, large commissions, large reports, major things, so on and so forth. And yet the carrying out of the kind of life of policy happens through a series of kind of minor gestures. So I guess what I'm wondering is maybe if you have some thoughts about that, about what your different papers say about the way we think about the scale of policymaking. I'll leave it to you to jump in.
I'll say a word or two about that. I really appreciated Stephen in particular the presence of your presentation, and I think for me Ira, you kind of talk about these minor gestures. I think more in terms of just the kind of momentariness, the timeliness, the immediacy of these sort of policy interactions, I'm just keep trying to sort of come to terms with this, but there's something about time. There's something about a sort of sweeping scale of time that we tend to sort of think about, and we tend to ignore the sort of momentary interjections, the moments. And I've just been reading some going back over Stuart Hall yet again for the 90 millionth time. To think about sort of those moments of the production circulation consumption scale. And I think that same kind of momentary intervention is something that we seem to be lacking in policy discussions. So anyway, that's sort of my thought on it. Stephen, it was more about space, but but I think there's something in there about time as well, right? When do they turn them off? What does that mean for people, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. For sure. What about you, Sherry or Taeyong or Geneva or Daniel, Stephen?
Oh, well, thanks, Lowell, for the feedback. And Ira, yeah, I like your idea of these minor gestures. And I think in terms of the TDO misfire, let's say, it did result in the expression of access concerns that maybe otherwise wouldn't have been articulated in a CRTC decision intervention. And so I think Geneva mentioned Bill C-10, and of course it's been in the news, sort of the only kind of non-pandemic news of late, really. I think all of the talks today do sort of point to important areas that I think the regulators and the MPs that are looking at the Broadcasting Act, they'd be very wise to look at the archive of this panel, because these are the sort of items that maybe aren't coming to the surface now in terms of concerns for the continued funding of Canadian programming, cultural programming, with the decline of cable and satellite delivery, the rise of streaming. I think the examples that have been given today really help to inform, the best step forward. And, incumbent broadcasters, what is the bargain that they're striking with citizens in terms of use of spectrum and preferred protections? How can we maybe enhance the current sort of setup for broadcasters, as opposed to trying to regulate audiovisual social media?
Yeah, that's an excellent point, Stephen, for sure. Yeah, Geneva, go ahead.
So thank you, everybody, for inviting me to have a chance to share my thoughts. I also want to thank all the other presenters for really amazing talks. Very, very interested in everything you guys have to say. So thank you for that. In terms of your question, Ira, I think that to a great extent, the minor, the small gestures that were mentioned, it's because we are holding the CRTC accountable to a 1991 Broadcasting Act and having to take apart these minor details and words to advise us on how well we are seeing ourselves reflected in our content, in our video on demand, or our cable, our streaming. And the problem that I'm noticing is that the content that Taeyong had brought up, the lack of visibility of even Canadian content on our own domestic streaming platforms, is a great example of how we need more than smaller gestures to achieve some regulation at even the smallest level to strengthen the type of Canadian content that we have had seen reflected in our broadcasting system on radio and on television cable. That being said, there are people who are against having more Canadian content because that would reduce the amount of choice. It would increase the amount of oversight in our streaming platforms, which right now we don't see. So that would be something that would have to be negotiated. But as I mentioned in my presentation, the consultations aren't there. And I think that's important, where we would require public consultation to actually see what Canadians want in their in their democratically elected CRTC overviews of the Bill C-10. Just small gestures, but we need large gestures too.
Oh yeah, no, for sure. And I think I think you're absolutely right. And I certainly wasn't suggesting that the small gestures are not important gestures, for sure. But just that, that in all of these cases, like once you get past the big ideas, then it's down to those things. Like, what are the best practices? What are the appropriate tools to use? What are the types of levels of access that are expected? I think you're absolutely right that there is such a tension between small and minor and major actions that I think your answer really nicely outlines. Any final thoughts as we are kind of running up against the end here? I'm sensing that might be the sign that Zoom fatigue has set in. So take the opportunity to thank you to thank all of you for coming, and to thank all of the presenters for excellent talks. Thank you, David, for technical support, and wishing you all a great rest of your day, and a happy and a healthy couple weeks and months ahead.